Father God, we thank you for this gathering of souls. You see that with two more gathering your name, that you're in the midst, so we thank you for your presence. We ask that the grace and blessings are upon the show this evening. We pray that any obstacle the devil plans to place in our path be removed in the name of Jesus. Lord, we thank you for the power in the word. And we also know that the most important thing we can hope for or desire is that our desires coincide with your will, because it will be your will. So we thank you, Father, for even the bad times, even the hard times. Because as long as you're in control, we know how it's going to turn out. We know how it's going to turn out. So we thank you, Father, for every single person that's in here. We praise your name and give you the glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You know, up until I was 20, you know, I was told I wouldn't live to see 20. I mean, so to just, you know, outlive everybody else's expectations, and not just outlive them, you know what I mean? Like, outperform them, you know what I mean? Outlast them, you know? I said, you gotta look at the blessing that it was, you know what I mean? Oh, you said I wasn't gonna live? Okay. Now I'm gonna fight harder to live.
Who to you was the MC that was the best at the art of freestyling? And I know you got LL standing here, but, you know, you can be on.
That's a tough one. The best, I mean, I'd have to say me. You know what I mean? I'd have to say that on the strength that, you know what I'm saying? I write what I like to hear.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so Pops wasn't around. And what bothered me about him not being around was that in my mother's photo album, there's a picture of him and me. I mean, I'm sitting in his lap. I guess he had like a strip of cowboy hat or something. I was trying the hat on. And I actually remember that, like, oh, this is the other half of this situation. It's supposed to be, you know, mom is just half. Like, wait, what? But, yeah, then I haven't seen him. I haven't seen him. So I was going to Philly to have a meeting with Rough House Columbia. My grandma said, you're not there to go see him. I'm like, all right, only because she said it. Like, at that point, I'm over it. Like, I don't give a. That is what it is, you know. Wish you the best. But I see him, and this pulled up with mother, you know, the corduroy suit with the patches on the elbow. He had the corduroy pants to match and three different pairs of leg warmers. I'm like, what the is this? Like, are you serious? This is how you get down? Like, you know. He's like, yo, like, I didn't have any place to live. It was best that you take it with your mother, like, you know. I think it was mad that he just met her, like, he was with another lady besides my mother. White lady, skinny, no teeth. And he said they were living in the park, Central Park. I'm like, wow. Okay. But I still didn't see us getting along. Because he was like, yeah, what are you doing? You got a lawyer? Like, I just didn't like the way you talk to me, you know what I'm saying? Like who the fuck you think you're talking to? You know what I mean? I wouldn't let nobody talk to me like that. You, oh, yeah, you just gotta do this. And like, tell me what to do. Fuck out of here. But, yeah, we're past that, man. And we actually have a pretty good relationship. I mean, I don't see him often. I can't take him in bulk. You know, a little bit at a time. You know? But he's less of a now, you know? So I guess that's a blessing, you know? Yeah, and I'm starting to see a lot of him and me. But I got me too, you know? I just choose not to most of the time. I'd like to say that me and my mother have a good relationship now. I wouldn't want to just dig up those skeletons, I mean, because she might see it, and, you know, I don't want to do anything to hurt her feelings in any way, you know, maybe because we are where we are. You know, it's not the perfect relationship, but, you know, like, Like, I got a mother, you know what I mean? And, you know, I love her, obviously, but, you know, it's different. It's different than it was growing up. But it was just levels to the like, you know, like, I pretty much had to just, like, forgive just because I don't want to hold on to it anymore. I have a lot of memories at three, being 3 years old. Standing by the sink next to my mother while she washed dishes. And the shade was always pulled down. And we lived in the basement, in the apartment building, so, you know, the door opened up the alley right there. But it just seemed like it was always dark. I mean, even in the daytime, it was just dark. I guess you didn't want people walking by looking, but, I mean, as dirty as the windows was, you know, that was an option. But, I remember hearing a song the night Chicago died. There was a fire happening, like, right in the block. You know, children can sense chaos. And I heard sirens, and I said, you know, the reflection of the light on the wall, and, you know, people out the street and everything. And that song came on. The night Chicago died. And I remember crying uncontrollably. Because I thought that was Chicago dying. And, like, it's just connected. Growing up in Yonkers, it really wasn't bad at all, you know, despite the, you know, conditions and circumstances. I mean, if that's all you know, you have nothing to gauge it with. So it just is. I mean, it just is. But my mother was in a band. I mean, she took us to band practice. It's like right down the block, like on the corner from where we lived at. And I touched the microphone stand, and I didn't know what turn it would do. Boom, it slammed down. Put one of those purple things on my finger. Yeah, never did that again. You gotta learn early.
I would take Earl to the conventions that they had. He had a little blue and white suit, and we'd go to the Bible studies, we went to the Kingdom Hall. You know, I wasn't strict with that and whatnot, but I gave them the basics of it.
Half Jehovah's Witness, I mean, half hood, I mean, like you know, you don't see too many families in the project like super dedicated and, you know, live by the letter of the word, you know what I mean? It wasn't really strict like that, you know what I mean? But, you know, I knew I had an ass whooping coming if I didn't do what my mother said, or if she told me to do something, I didn't do it. So, this is one time we were staying, a friend of hers.
I took Earl and his sister Benita with me. She lived at 100 Harriet in Yonkers. And they had these metal bars that's between the sidewalk and the street, so the cars can't go up in there, give the kids a chance to play.
You know, we go in front of the building, but, you know, Mom said, don't leave her in front of that building. And I found a dime. The guy was gone. Went to the store, got a lollipop and a ball. You know, the balls that bounce and they go forward, Super Bowl.
Okay, I go upstairs. Next thing I hear this here beep, beep, somebody's buzzing. My friend's number, her bell. I go, they say, Earl got hit.
Yeah, as soon as I stepped up the curb coming out from the store, a car hit me. Knocked me. We were on the other side of the street, up under another car. I was so worried about getting an ass whooping, I was trying to get up. I'm like, no. Like, she's not going to understand. Like, you know, I knew that, you know. This white lady with a clipboard, you know, was like, lay down. You know, as a child, if an adult acknowledges the fact that you're hurt, it turns on the waterworks, you know? So I just lay down there, and the people started, you know, covering me, give me a hoodie or a pillow, whatever.
Now I'm panicking. I go downstairs, he laying in the street, his head up on the sidewalk. Somebody gave him a jacket or something, look up, like they put it under his head, you know? I'm like, Earl, what did I tell you? I know, Mom, I found a dime. He still had the lollipop and the ball in his hand, laying in the street.
Like, I didn't see the lady no more. And you would think that she'd have stuck around because she saw the whole thing. I mean, like, I don't know. I felt like it was an angel. She had no business being in the hood with a f***ing clipboard. I mean, what are you doing? I mean,
the ambulance came. I said to myself, I said, I think he went through enough punishment. I'm not gonna punish him again for what he did. He know now, but he never did that again, you know.
I became a problem in kindergarten. And it really wasn't my fault. I mean, it really wasn't my fault.
In kindergarten, well, see, I was the one that was boo-boo the fool. Because my thing was, oh, my son is not bad. I don't know what y'all talking about. He is so good because he was good at home.
I mean, this kid, Junior, you know, we started hanging out, you know, trading Matchbox cars and, you know, like, this is my friend.
I get to school, Earl is in there cutting up. He's doing this, he's doing that. He's not paying attention to the teachers and whatnot. Earl, he tell me, Mama, I've already gone over that stuff. Why do I have to continue to go over the stuff again and again? He got bored, and that's when he started, you know, with his little tricks and trying to make everybody laugh and whatnot, you know, and he continued that from kindergarten all through, you know, his schooling.
You know, it's one thing to have siblings. It's another thing to have, like, a whole friend like that. Oh, like, you know, but I really wasn't that social anyway, but, you know, we hit it off. And we did the fire drills like you do in every school, you know, and it's these two girls, twins, in my class. And, they used to, like, make fun of my name, which to me didn't make sense. They're like, that's stupid. Like, Earl LaPearl, what a squirrel. Like, all right, like, you know, this doesn't make sense. Like, joke's on you, dummy. Because that's because, though, like, when you grow up with family, one thing you don't teach each other about is your name. I mean, you know, you might talk about somebody fat or somebody skinny or, you know, all that. You know, but, you know, the name, like, that doesn't make sense. So I was kind of, like, over it. And then Junior fell out in class. And, you know, the fire department came and like, all that. So it was real. It got real quick, you know. And we come back to school the next day, he's not in class. The next day, he's not in class. And, you know, they should have explained it. I mean, he do all this shit with the fire drill and everything. I mean, like, why don't I explain this? You know, he's sick. He's got to go to the hospital. Whatever. Fine. You know, and after the second day, you know, the twins got back to their normal shit. Earl LaPearl, and I just like blacked out and beat the shit out of him. Yeah.
Instead of coming home after school every day, Earl would go. The first time he did that, we found him on Elm Street in a parking lot playing with a tire. And so, because I had called the cops because I was so scared, I didn't know where he was, if anything had happened to him. They took him down to a holding cell, and I had to go down there and get him. And I told them, I said, can you open up the cell and let me in there for 2 seconds? He was like, no, don't open up the cell and let her in here for no seconds. I said, just two, that's all I need is 2 seconds. I'd gone back and forth to court with him, and the judge told me, he said, find somewhere or we will find some place for him.
See, this group homes is usually like a house, you know, out in the public. I mean, you know, kids come and go, whatever, that type of shit. I was in like a couple of institutions where it's like, we never left the grounds.
The judge said, well, since you didn't find a place, here's a place, you pack his bag, and you take him there, and you leave him. He can't leave with you. You leave him there.
And I was mad about that for a while.
And I'm like, oh, that's gonna be kind of touchy. You know, I said, can I say goodbye? No, it's better this way if you don't say goodbye to him. So I left him there, and I walked to the bus, and I cried all the way home because he didn't know what was happening because the judge told me, you know, just take him there and leave him there, you know, because he wasn't going to school the way he was supposed to.
How you gonna let these people tell you what to do with me, especially when every time he whooped my ass and I had to go to school with a sore ass, and then I made sure I didn't tell him what happened, You know, she said, what happens I'll stay in the house? I was like, all right, you know, hell up to my end. Now you gonna listen to these same motherfuckers and, you know. I did have a good teacher, Miss Smith, black lady, prune face, with the bun. Always had the bun. And I was up to my shenanigans, you know. Man, I'd be starting class, whatever. It's like, come here. I was like, oh man, I'm about to hear it now. And she brought me out of the classroom. She's like, yo, what you doing? And they're like, they're going to be all right. You're going to have to work twice as hard to get what they got. And I think that's the first time I saw her as a person, a loving, caring person. Like, oh, like, did you just relate to me on a black level? Like, did we just connect on some like, okay. Yeah, and yeah. To this day, that was my best teacher. She's the first person that I felt like understood, saw me. You mean?
Came out with Get At Me Dog. Every street, corner, car. Y'all niggas wanna be killers? Get At Me Dog. It was all over, and that's how we knew, oh, it's on.
If you're from our town, it's hard to describe to the world, but he set, I mean, it's not because it actually affected the whole world. Now you got Rough Riders everywhere, dogs everywhere. People connected to dogs, people, loving people connected to dogs, but he is the actual dog. I don't know if y'all ever had, like, when you're having a personal conversation with someone and they really growl and bark at any given moment you're talking and it's part of their vocabulary, what else could you consider them but an actual dog man?
I don't see how people could not love a dog. And then, like, you know, you could, not that I did this, right, but you could beat the shit out of your dog. Go to the store, you come back, he'll be happy to see you. I mean, so two things capable of unconditional love. Dog, God. Yeah? Same words, spelled backwards. So, I really feel like dogs are, you know, they're close to God. I don't know if that came out right. I think it's just a gift, like a genuine gift. Oh God, was this, I think those were the first pets I only had was a dog. You know, companion. It's smart enough to communicate with you, but dumb enough to not get on your nerves. Yeah. They don't talk back. You know, they don't lie to you. Might steal a sandwich or two, but you know, that's to be expected. But yeah, a dog doesn't know how to be phony. It's not his DNA.
I guess it was a friendship thing. He didn't have a lot of friends, and he didn't click with a lot of people, but he always said, dogs will be loyal to you to the end. Him and the dogs just clicked, and they were with him all the time. Like even Boomer, him and Boomer did robberies together.
Boomer. My dog, Boomer. Yeah, I used to rob people with my dog. You know, because at the end of the day, people are more scared of a dog than a gun. You know, a gun is only as powerful as the person behind it. Where a dog is like, I'm going to chase you, and I'm going to catch you. Like, you know, you can't outrun me. He can jump fences, anything. So, we go to this block. I ain't going to say the street, but go to this block, and late night, you know what I mean? I'm on my bullshit. You know, I'm coming patting down type. And it was two of them together. I said, all right, you go in this building. And stripped him out. And yeah, I told woman to watch him. And just sit there. And I went, checked this man all crazy. And I came back, and he was in tears. Like, yo, just get the dog, man. I mean, if he did something, Boomer would have bit him. It would took me a little while to get over there. So, yeah, those are the days. Yeah. Yeah, I lost Boomer in Baltimore, though. Bugged me out too. It's like, who the fuck hits a dog? It's like, it's three lanes this way, three lanes that way, sidewalk in the middle. Like, you could go around. And like, I watched my boy die right in front of me. And they just kept going. Like, I mean, I feel like God was with them though. Because if they would have stopped, I was already out there doing some illegal shit anyway. I mean, if they would stop, I'd have killed everybody in the van and just went home. So the one time I didn't do the robbery, I got blamed for the robbery. What happened was, I robbed the that robbed the. What the f*** are the odds of that happening? You mean, like, you serious? And so I doubled back with the jewels and the coat. And like, yo, this my little cousin. I'm like, huh? And the description he gave him, well, it looked like me, because, you know. Like, this is some bullshit. This is some bullshit. I actually walked with him to go meet up with the kids. I'm like, nah, he gonna see, like, because that's my man's son. And he was 16, he old enough to be in the street or whatever, but, you know, like, I wouldn't do that. I wasn't robbing kids. And as an adult, as a kid, I was robbing kids, you know. But, yeah, man, I had a knife in my hoodie pocket, too. And it just fell out. Like, well, like, what the? And then, like, once I saw the direction, you know, turning, I, you know, pop, 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 bang, you know what I mean? And I didn't even get a chance to. And I hung out of the bill, like, all right, leave it alone. Like, damn, it was a nice one, too. I'd have put some work in. I would have put some work in.
I am the street. I will be the voice of the street till I die. Because I know if I keep my heart real, I'm going to fly. For real, you know? I am the street. I am the street. I keep my ear to the street, my heart close to the ground, my words go in the air.
When Leor had came to the studio, I guess, you know, I guess God, he just, like, beat him in the head with me so much. He was like, I need to see this motherfucker myself. And I remember my jaw was wired shut. Yeah, but, like, it was, like, the room was packed, too. Like, it's, you know, every MC in Yonkers was there. But when I came in, it's like they parted like the Red Sea. Like, oh, okay. You know, I guess they felt like they had a shot until I got there. You know, and I must be some and he was like, he didn't really show it. He's just like, okay, all right. And, you know, and next thing I do is like, all right, let's do it. It's like, wow. So I'm sure this is the first and only time the remix to a song came out before the actual song. So the whole purpose of a remix is remixing it. But we did a remix, the Get At Me Dog remix. What must I go through to show you is real? And I ain't really never gave a kind of fit. Rob and I slip, because I want to, because I have to. And don't make me show you with the back. Me, Sheik, and niggas, Clue, they're like, yo, why your man always go last? Da, 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 da. It don't matter where I go in the song. I know what I'm going to do, you know what I mean? So I put that joint out, and it's on his mixtape, too. Yeah. And then Leo was like, I want the same beat, do the barking thing, and give me three verses. I'm like, I was a little discouraged, because I knew I had, like, way better lyrics, like, songs that meant something. He just asked for three verses, and he was the hook. But, I mean, he saw what I didn't. I mean, the grasp it would have on the public, and, you know, I mean, later conversations, he had expressed to me that he lost his love for the whole industry because of the direction it was going, you know. And he's like, if he met me, he's like, you know, he was inspired again. And to hear that, you know, from someone who's been in the industry for so long, you know, it's, for me, it was just a humbling experience. I mean, it was something to be extremely grateful for. And, so I was definitely grateful. Like, wow, like, and I somehow ran around telling people, you know what I mean? Like, you know, a lot of them, like, look at me like, you crazy, but, you know, it's just something to know and to hold on to. I mean, I think that's what you do with the things that really matter. I mean, you hold on to them. I always feel like I'm gonna look back on my life just before I go and thank God for every moment, for every single moment. Because, you know, it's those moments like drops of water in the ocean, you know? When they come together, you see the beauty of who you are and why you are. I don't know how different things would have been if that incident hadn't happened with, you know, the man that used to rhyme and that would do the beatbox for. But it's not something that I think about, I mean, I like to stay in the here and now. I mean, and I also like genuinely believe that everything happens for a reason. Me and my man, Reg, God bless the dead man, we went out to the robbery and I asked him if he wanted to come with us. And he's like, no, 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 that nigga's crazy. All right, me and Reg went, boom, bust the hole. We come back running the building. He's like, oh, yo, shit, yo, did it? Like, yeah, dude, we got a plane. It's raining too. And so it was his birthday. So, you know, we go upstairs and count money. And I'm like, all right, why don't you, yeah, take this $50 for your birthday. Go do something. Mm-hmm. Like, you know, just don't want somebody who ain't getting nothing sitting there counting your money for you, with you. You know? And, he came back with the already rolled up. I mean, now looking at it, it's like, I really feel like he was trying to get me started. Yeah, well, I never even thought about that like that. Yeah. Like, I don't mean to say, he passed around. At one time, I remember, like, the focus wasn't on counting the money no more. The focus was like, yo, where'd the blunt go? Where'd the blunt go? And then he opened the window, and I, like, put it out on the ledge and said, oh, I dropped it. If you dropped it, you said something when you dropped it. You wait for the nigga to ask you, where'd the blunt go? And you're like, oh, I dropped it. What the fuck out of here? I mean, I should have read that situation for what it was. You know, the pettiness that comes with that type of situation. I just wrote about it. It's one of the verses in a song I got called Pain. And I smoked crack at 14 for the first time, given to me by a that I idolized. My love is real, but after that, what I saw in his eyes was a snake, and who I loved was just a disguise. And I guess I really never knew the real him. Yeah? I feel like the most important part about being a father is teaching children the principles they should have, and teaching them their values. I mean, and to see it, you know, it come into play that they have is that just being someone that like I like being someone that like whatever you're going through, come talk to me. You know what I mean, like whatever, you know, it is what it is. You know, at the end of the day. It's like parents are not good parents just because they have a child. They're just parents. Two people and a baby. You know what I mean? They don't get a parent degree, you know, so the baby comes out I'm like, oh, I know everything about babies now, you know. So it's the same way with kids. You know what I mean? Like, you know, you're gonna have a different relationship with different kids. Yeah, so. It is what it is. Like, from not having a father, like I dove into it. Like, you know, going to, like, amusement park with him, teaching him how to ride a bike, roller skate, drive, shoot a gun. You know what I mean? Like, you know, the fundamentals. So, to everyone watching, I just want to say that, you know what? Sometimes blessing come in the form of a hard time or a difficult situation. Right. Lord, you keep that frame of mind. Whatever you're going through will be easy to deal with. Because you know that on the other end, God is waiting with your boarding pass. Come on, let's go. You know? Yeah. Give it to God. Give it to God.
When we were called to do Ianla, I was actually shooting Starter Wives. And they wanted to do a swap where I come in and Xavier come in and they do something with Earl. I was totally against it with him and my son because I knew that my son was very fragile at the time.
Challenging you every time in the house.
You've never attempted to challenge.
But you're not letting him finish.
Hey, please.
No.
What the man? Man.
Hold on.
Listen, this is my son right here. I'm talking to him.
I mean, in all fairness, and even bringing up the what happened on the show. I mean, so when I came home from prison, she reached out to, you know, my team was like, I apologize. And so that was like really big. I mean, not just apologize, but to realize that you were wrong. I mean, you know, and I appreciate that very much. We went to a couples therapy when I was married. Me and my wife went to couples therapy. You know, the TV show.
Not once she ever, that she ever told me that she loved me. I mean, I don't sound like a sucker.
You don't sound like a sucker.
It is what it is. It is what it is. I mean, a lot of people.
I mean, a lot of people don't get that. So, I mean, what's the big deal? So what? She didn't say she loved me. So what?
I guess during one of the council sessions or whatever, you know, I just mentioned some things about my mother.
I just felt really connected with Earl at that time because I had realized that the void that he was missing was from his mother. And it was the nurturer in me at the time that I wanted to be. From me being abandoned and being an older child, I was a nurturer. So me and him automatically just bonded.
I remember we was in one of our council sessions one day, and a lady said, how would you feel if you saw your mother right now? I'm like, I don't know. Like, yeah, of course I love her, but, you know, I didn't know.
I remember Arnett being nervous because she didn't know what to expect. She didn't know the mindset that her son was going to be in. But I remember her wanting to do it because it was for him. And just my opinion, I felt that Arnett was coming into a place where she wanted to do what was best for her son.
And then she asked, well, I came in and she walked. She walked in the door, and I think it's at that point right there that I just let everything go. I mean, that's how, you
know. I'm like, sit down, let me tell you this. And I told him about the court and what the judge said and what happened when I went to Children's Village. And he looked at me and he cried. He said, Ma, I didn't know that. I said, I know. I know you didn't know. I said, but I want you to know. I said, no matter what anybody said, I don't ever want you to think you were not loved. I said, you was loved. I said, it broke my heart to leave you there.
She crying, I'm crying. It was like a, I don't know, a different, it wasn't a hurt cry. It was like, yes, this is what I need. And then, yeah. Yeah.
So me and Earl were together about 11 years. Before his transition into being famous, he struggled a lot with insecurities of his worth because of the void from his mom. But he was always so confident in who God was and the gift that God had given him. And it was so inspiring to me. So in the 11 years of our relationship, when he was discovered, I was excited for him, that's number one, because he was finally being able to do what he knew best, what he was most confident. I mean, because he even struggled with not feeling handsome enough, you know, and stuff like that. So, you know, coming into an industry that embraced his gift, I saw it did something to him.
He is a runner. If you're not gonna put him in a secure place, you might as well leave him home. Cause he, first chance he get, he's gonna see that it's all nice and y'all gonna think, oh, well, he's a good person. He's gonna stay here and we can trust him to do. First chance, he ain't doing nothing but scoping out the place.
I was in this place of state, medium security, and me and his white boy escaped.
Earl got in good and he took his time and he's watching and waiting. He said it wasn't so secure up there and whatnot. Next thing I know, I get a phone call. Earl's escaped. I'm like, what you mean escape? Weren't y'all watching him? Well, yeah, but we didn't see when he left. You know, he was on this here work thing, and the bus, when the bus rolled back up in here, Earl wasn't on the bus. Him and a friend of his. I think it was two of them had left.
And, you know, you get 5 years automatically for escape. You know, and it was a middle, we left on December 16th. Upstate New York, snow, crazy, everything.
Earl told me when he got to the house, he said, I said, why are you limping? He said, I was out there running. He said, Ma, they sick the dogs on us and whatnot. And the dog bit me on my heel. He said he met a nice lady. She took him to a hotel or her place and gave him something to eat. And then she bought him a ticket on home, I think, to the rest of the way to Yonkers. He knocked on the door and opened the door. He was standing there. I'm like, don't you know they're looking for you? He like, yes. He said, I know, Ma. So I let him come in. I fixed his wound on his leg. I changed his clothes. I said, you can't wear this. I said, because they know what you ran away in. I said, you got to go to your grandmother's house now, right now, because they know exactly where you live. And the first place they're going to come is here looking for you.
And I just stopped by my mom's house, let her know I was all right. Then I went to see her grandmother.
I said, how'd you get it? He said, I ran. He said, I got rides from people and whatnot. I said, thank God they were nice people. I said, because I could be reading about your little monkey hips in the paper. And that's exactly what I told him. Yes. So he went to his grandmother's house and he stayed there. I don't know how long he stayed there. And the detectives came to my house looking for him. I said, well, he's not here. Which he wasn't. Do you know where he's at? I'm like, I'm not sure. He's got a number of people, places he can go to, so I'm not sure where he's at. They're like, okay, we'll find him. Somebody must have told them that he was at his grandmother's house, or they probably seen him, because I never told them that he was at his grandmother's house. I told them, I said, I'm not sure where he's at right now, you know, because I really didn't want him to go back, but they said he had to, so, you know, I'm not sure how they found out that he was over there. I don't know.
And like, all right, you know, you had your fun, the holidays over. And I said to myself, like, what the f made you think I escaped for the holidays? You know what I mean? Like, you know. And I was thinking about that 5 years too, like, damn, yo. But it never happened. It never happened. I was like, wow, that had to be God. That had to be God. You know?
X was just a free spirit. Like, he touched everybody in different levels. Like, it just was more than rap. Spiritually, physically, like, he literally resonated in people's hearts. Like, it was, that right there was just something that everybody would wish that they could actually do in their lifetime.
One of my favorite Bible verses is Romans chapter 7, 14. All the way to the end. And, it's pretty much, so we know that the law is spiritual, but I am carnal, soul is a slave to sin. What I want to do, I do not. What I don't want to do, I find myself doing it. If then I do what I don't want to do, it's no longer I who does it, but the sin that dwells within me. And it goes on, but it's basically explaining why, how someone can love God, I mean, and you know, desire for God to be like you know, bigger in their life, yet still walk backwards every now and then. You know? That would be a hell of a question, you know, to ask.
I want my brother to be remembered for his love for people, his prayers. Like, no matter what he was going through, he could always stop and pray for people, which always would amaze me, because I'm just like, you can stop on the drop of a dime and pray for anyone. And I'm just like, but how about yourself? He gave so much of himself to people and just put himself literally out there, like gave himself to the world.
I definitely think God sent the angel when I got hit by the car. Because she's like disappeared. Like, first of all, like, she was so out of place. Like, you know, and I only thought about that afterwards. Like, I knew she was out of place at 4 years old, so, you know? And, man, I mean, if he has a message for you, God will find a way to get you the message, get the message to you. But a lot of communication is, done by signs, things happening, you know? When they happen, like, oh, wow, like, yo, like, you know? So it's like, I mean, that's one way that he made sure that you, and only you, receive that message. And at the same time, strengthen your relationship with him. You know, that's one thing I really, really love about God. Like, you know, he'll show me something and just, you know, get a warm feeling in the heart, like, wow. You know, just keep it to yourself. Like, you know, all I know, like, I don't give a f- who else knows. I mean, I gotta prove it. We thank you, Lord. I think you've given us this day. Things that we forget are actual blessings. The air we breathe, the food we eat, the clothes we wear, the water we drink, the cars we drive, the lives we touch, and the lives that touch our own. Let us be reminded to be humble in every situation, Father, because it is not of our doing. We praise your name, Lord, and ask that you continue to guide our steps. Have your will, have your way in our lives. We didn't make us, so we couldn't possibly know what to do with us. We thank you, Father, for each other's life. And we ask that you release the angels that are encamped around each of us, Father, for our protection. We thank you. All these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you. Thank you. Yeah.